place I know and spread our blanket next to the sky. I'll take you to Spain someday.
From the beach where Columbus first landed on the island, Marcus Garvey was born August 17, 1887. At that time, Jamaica was a British colony. A small minority of white colonial masters ruled over a black majority. To be white was to be rich, to be black was to be poor. Although slavery had been abolished more than 50 years before, the white man remained the master and the black man the servant as the 19th century came to a close. Most Jamaicans lived off the land. Their forefathers had been captured and brought from Africa to work as slaves on the sugar plantations. After the abolition of slavery in 1833, most of the former slaves wanted to own and farm their own land. But the only plots they were able to obtain were on the rocky hillsides, and so many of them were once again forced to work on the plantations as laborers. Marcus Garvey described the black man's condition in this way.
In Jamaica, black men have no special advantages. You are slated to be a cowhand or laborer, a blacksmith or shoemaker. I looked at the system that man fixed for me, and I said, this does not suit me.
But only a few thought along the same lines. Most Jamaicans did not question the rigid social hierarchy based on color and race. Without a protest, they carried their produce to be sold abroad for the benefit of Mother England. A few managed to move forward within the strict social order. They became tradesmen or skilled workers. St. Anne's Bay today. The small market town has a population of about 2,000, and its main source of income is agriculture and the pepper trade. There is not much tourism here, and the famous son, Marcus Garvey, has not yet been shamelessly exploited by his native town. Little has changed in St. Anne's Bay since Garvey was a child. Many of the old houses still stand, and people are still living in them. St. Anne's Bay was once a major port. Peppers were shipped from here all over the world. Today, Kingston has replaced St. Anne's Bay, and the once busy port has become a sleepy little market town. Marcus Garvey remembers his childhood here.
To me, at home in my early days, there was no difference between white and black. One of my father's properties, the place where I lived most of the time, was adjoining that of a white man. He had three girls and two boys. The Wesleyan minister, another white man whose church my parents attended, also had property adjoining ours. He had three girls and one boy. All of us were playmates. The little white girl, whom I liked most, knew no better than I did myself. We were two innocent fools who never dreamed of a race feeling and problem. At 14, my little white playmate and I were parted. Her parents sent her to Scotland, and told her that she was never to write or try and get in touch with me, for I was a nigger. It was then that I found for the first time that there was some difference in humanity, and that there were different races, each having its own separate and distinct social life.
Isaac Samuel Rose is over 100 years old. He recalls his school days. When I go to school, me and he go to Wesleyan Church, and there I sit upon the platform there, and they sing a hymn and read psalms. But the boys were true boys, and they write a note and drop it to the girls, and the girls read them and laugh. So the parson sent Marcus' father to keep the boys them in order. And he sit down, and the cool breeze take him, and he fall asleep with his mouth open. And the boys them make a cigar out of paper, and they light it, and they put it in his mouth. So Marcus was beside me, and I saw them laugh. So I turned around to look, and I touched Marcus to show him. So Marcus picked up Saunders and fling him down the staircase. Everybody look up and thought Saunders dead. Kingston, the capital of Jamaica at the turn of the century. Marcus Garvey came here in 1905 to work as an apprentice in one of the biggest printing plants in town. Kingston was not only the most important harbor of the island, it was also the place in which a newly conscious working class was developing. For a young man coming from the country, Kingston offered a new and exciting experience. The streets were crowded and the rhythm of life was fast and hectic. It was in Kingston that Garvey first came into conflict with the new black middle class. Garvey wrote,
"Representative and educated Negroes have made the mistake of drawing and keeping themselves away from race, thinking that it is degrading and ignominious to identify themselves with the masses of the people who are still ignorant and backward, but who are crying out for true and conscientious leadership."
In 1907, Garvey organized a printer's strike and lost his job.
"I saw the injustice done to my race because it was black. I went traveling to South and Central America and parts of the West Indies, and I found the same situation. I set sail for Europe, and again I found the stumbling block, you are black. After I returned in 1914, I founded the UNIA, Universal Negro Improvement Association."
Monroe Scarlett, a former associate.
"Called a Wakefield Cultural Society. As Marcus Garvey said, it was necessary for people to work on their own behalf. Naturally, we were British subjects, but that didn't impair the fact that we were people of African descent. And it was necessary for the black man, and by black man that meant the people of African descent, you know what that covers, to have an interest in themselves and in the coming into being, into the new day of Africa's renaissance."
"I never really knew there was so much color prejudice in Jamaica until I started the work of the UNIA. Men and women as black as I, and even more so, had believed themselves white under the West Indian order of society. And I had to decide whether to please my friends and be one of the black whites of Jamaica and be reasonably prosperous, or come out openly and defend and help improve and protect the integrity of the black medians and suffer. I decided to do the latter."
In search of a wider field to realize his ideas, Marcus Garvey went to the United States in 1916. Harlem. New York. The United States of America. Beginning of the century, Harlem seemed to offer to blacks the possibility of fulfilling the American dream of rags to riches. They had come in search of work from the poverty-stricken South to the cities of the North. They were social refugees from the racial discrimination of the Deep South, from lynchings and pogroms. But already at the end of the First World War, disillusionment began to set in. The arms industry did not need to take on any new workers, and the white workers began to return from the battlefields. White immigrants began to pour in again from Europe to the promised land in the hope of making their fortune. The trade unions began to set up a color bar once again and refused to accept black workers. Racial discrimination spread in the North. Black workers received less pay than whites for the same job. And the black living areas began to degenerate into slums. Bitterness and disillusionment have always made Harlem susceptible to promises of redemption. Marcus Garvey was one of the first in a long line of prophets and saviors. Even the black Muslims based many of their tenets on Garvey's ideas and vision. Their founder and leader, Elijah Muhammad, used to be a member of Garvey's movement, just like the parents of Malcolm X and Muhammad Ali. The red, black, and green flag of the UNIA still waves at the corner of 125th Street. And a park in the center of Harlem recalls the radical days of the 20s. The armistice was signed. The First World War came to an end. Although the Afro-American made up only about 10% of the population of the USA, 13% of America's World War I soldiers were black. They were sent to the battlefields to defend democracy, but there was no place for them even in their own army. Racial segregation in the US Army forced the Afro-American soldiers to fight alongside the French troops. The U.S. military command was worried because they feared that the black soldiers had been influenced by French ideas of equality and fraternity. In spite of the disappointment and disillusionment, Harlem continued to attract new immigrants. Gamblers and speculators in the construction industry made huge profits. Soon Harlem was one of the most densely populated areas of New York. Marcus Garvey was also one of the new immigrants, and a very critical one.
The Negroes are determined to suffer no longer. We are going in for mass organization. In the past, we have worked separately and individually. Now, we are going to organize.
Marcus Garvey's message did not fall on deaf ears. Many Afro-Americans were now convinced that they had neither a home nor a future in the USA. In 1919, Marcus Garvey founded the UNIA, the Universal Negro Improvement Association, in the United States. It was an immediate success. Changes also took place in his private life. He was divorced and remarried. Amy Jacques, a Jamaican who lived in New York. She was to become his closest and most reliable associate. Marcus and Amy had two sons. The eldest, Marcus, recalls,
"For the first time, black people all over the world began to come together. So the impact, the great impact of the UNIA was to unify. identify African people in different parts and to point them in the direction towards nationhood. Because the Garveyite program of the UNIA called for the mobilization of African people outside to return to Africa. And this purpose was quite clear, although it was not expressed by the people who commented on Marcus Garvey. It was very clear what was intended. It was the building of a strong central nation in Africa. And this concept was quite different from that of the Negroes who were here in the United States and the Negroes outside of the United States who call themselves leaders, because they were really just isolated tribesmen crying out for to improve the working conditions of black people and their social conditions. They were not concerned with the building of nationhood.
The UNI contended that black Americans would never become truly emancipated until they became an economic power. Garvey stated over and over again that people could not call themselves free if they were economically dependent. He wrote in an article,
"The Universal Negro Improvement Association, as everyone will admit, the most thoughtful Negro movement in the world, is now, according to the need of the time, emphasizing economic expansion and solidarity among Negroes. We have to make new conquests in the economic field. We must have wealth in culture, wealth in education, and solid wealth of real economic values."
Garvey founded the Negro World as the official newspaper of the UNIA. Marianne Samad remembers her childhood as a member of the UNIA.
"We were called the elite now, if that can help you, by the main paper of the United States, the New York Times, said that Garvey had evolved an elitist group. I didn't have to do as other children did, to say that, well, I was a Negro, and so I was at the bottom of the barrel. We use the term Negro in the organization because that's what Mr. Garvey had to use, because he was, remember, not a naturalized citizen of the country. So he used the term Negro, but we ourselves are calling me Negro Black, we were African. And that made it so different. I love my life as a child. It was a good life. We had our own God. We didn't have a white God. We had our African fundamentalism that we grew up under. Mr. Garvey told us who we were, that the Sphinx, the pyramids were all ours, that the ancient kings, the African kings were in the Bible. He showed us, he pointed them out to us. He gave us black angels. Now, this was amazing. And some people were rather worried. The woman was glorified in the family. She was the mother who taught. And above her, she was protected by the Almighty. The Jesus child looks like her. So therefore, to explain my childhood, I would have to say I was as perfect as maybe any white child in existence. This was our standard. The red, black, and the green. The original one that Mr. Garvey himself would have held. The red for one blood of black men all over the world. Black meaning the black peoples of the world wherever we were. And green for Mother Africa.
Also made him an important person in his immediate environment. James Thornhill, a British seaman, was a captain in the African Legion.
I'd come here from England, and when I come here, I heard him lecturing about Africa. I got interested and stopped. He said, I would like you to give you some of the documents of the organization to take with you. And wherever you go, whatever country you're going, you give them to black people.
But not all black people were receptive to Garvey's message. The established leaders of the black communities, preachers, ward politicians, and the small, aggressive middle class of blacks rejected his ideas. They despised his followers and ridiculed Garvey. He was openly attacked by the oldest organization of black Americans, the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People. Its president, W.E.B. Du Bois, scoffed. When Mr. Garvey brought his cohorts to Madison Square Garden, clad in fancy costumes and with new songs and ceremonies, and when ducking his dark head at the audience, he yelled, "We are going to tell England, France, and Belgium to get out of Africa." America sat up, listened, laughed, and said, "Here at least is something new."
They're asking black people to go out on the streets to fight in order that a few people can reap the rewards, the so-called middle class. Now, these middle class are entirely selfish people. They were concerned with the fact that they had achieved status here.
Garvey knew that Harlem loved colorful parades, and none of them was so full of pomp and pageantry as the annual convention of the UNIA. Thousands of delegates from all over the world marched through the streets carrying banners and flags. The UNIA Music Corps led the parade, followed by the African Legion, the African Motor Corps, the Black Cross Nurses, and then came the thousands of members of the UNIA and followers. With the exception of the white dresses of the Black Cross Nurses, the members of all the other militant organizations were clad in extravagant uniforms in the red, black, and green colors of the UNIA. However, the main attraction of every parade was the self-appointed provisional president of Africa himself, Marcus Mosiah Garvey. Within a few years, Garvey had managed to organize the largest mass movement for blacks that had ever existed. His claim that the UNIA had more than 2 million members may have been slightly exaggerated, but was not improbable. His followers were mostly simple people who found consolation and purpose in belonging to the proud African nation whose greatness Garvey promised would soon be restored. Garvey taught the black peoples of the Americas to have self-respect and to be proud of their appearance, their race, and their African motherland. These concepts have formed the ideological basis of all the black militant organizations that followed the UNIA, from the Black Panthers to the Black is Beautiful movement. Garvey even influenced such African nationalists as Jomo Kenyatta and Kwame Nkrumah, as well as the student struggles in Soweto. Garvey called to the crowds,
"Sons and daughters of Africa, I say to you, arise, take on the toga of race pride, and throw off the brand of ignominy which has kept you back for so many centuries. Dash asunder the petty prejudices within your own fold. Set at defiance the scornful designation of nigger, uttered even by yourselves, and be a negro in the light of the pharaohs of Egypt.
Universal African Royal Guard. This covered one God, one aim, one destiny. It covered everything that a nation should be, a people. Mr. Garvey knew, like Lincoln, that we couldn't be a nation within a nation. But he kept asking, where are our kings? Where are our generals? Where are our presidents? Where are our ships? Where are our anything?
Garvey founded a number of business enterprises, but the one that seemed to mark the realization of his dreams was the Black Star Line, the shipping line that was exclusively owned by small black shareholders to carry passengers and cargo between Africa, the Caribbean, and the United States. Many believed that the Black Star Line was the beginning of a huge fleet that would one day carry the descendants of the slaves back across the Middle Passage to Africa.
These songs of freedom, cause all I ever have,
brought by the organization, was scarcely seaworthy.
Redemption songs, redemption songs. Emancipate yourselves from mental slavery. None but ourselves can free our minds. Have no fear for atomic energy, cause none of them can stop the time.
How long shall they kill our prophets? With using the United States mails in an attempt to defraud.
And when they went to trial, they struck Judge Julian Mack and District Attorney Maddock. They offered Mr. Garvey $15 bail, and he said, not $15,000 of my money, but nickels and dimes of black people before I should see this money go into the hands of the white man. I'd rather the walls of all federal prison crumbling on a black neck.
In 1924, Garvey lost his case and was sentenced to 5 years in prison. He was paroled after 2.5 years and deported to Jamaica. Garvey's radical ideas and organizational talents had made him many enemies in the United States. Not the least of them was the U.S. Department of Justice itself, which regarded Garvey's militant organization with suspicion and hoped that it would fall apart without its charismatic leader. Marcus Garvey arrived back in Kingston in 1927. He got a hero's welcome. It was the biggest crowd that Kingston had ever seen. Garvey began almost immediately to reorganize the local UNIA. His convention hall, Liberty Hall, once stood on this now empty lot on King Street. Directly across the way was the Da Costa restaurant, where he often had lunch. The situation in Jamaica was different from that in the United States, Garvey noted.
The sleeping West Indian has ignored his chance ever since emancipation. The Negroes of the West Indies need a terrific sensation to awaken them to their racial consciousness.
In his cultural center, Edelweiss Park, today a parking lot, Garvey tried to encourage a new black local culture.
At Edelweiss Park, we had the usual divisional operations. We had the Boy Scouts, Girl Guides, and such things. And in all that, yours truly was very active. I wrote poems, I wrote songs, and things of that matter which were used by... the boys and girls, and did much to promote what he was saying.
Edelweiss Park provided local artists with a regular platform for their talents. Many famous Jamaican entertainers began their careers at Edelweiss Park. And we go by Edelweiss Park. When I see that place, I see only two people. After a while, the place crammed with people. I see Marcus. I take a lower seat. When I take the lower seat, I see Marcus's choir come out. And they dress in white, all of them. White shoes, white dress, white skirt, white hat. And them bodyguard, them come out dressed in black suit with a white braid, and them hat is black like a police hat, but with white braid. And after I see him bodyguard come out, I see two men come out with the sword, and them walk with the sword over Marcus's head. And Marcus stepped up on the pulpit, and he passed me. As me say, me ask for Marcus, and somebody say, you know him, sir. And when him say, you know him, me say, yes, man. And the woman sit down beside me, and she say, yes, son. And we listen to all the service he had, a lovely service. Marcus Garvey did not content himself with creating a welfare and cultural organization in Jamaica. He said,
from the moral, legal, industrial, economical, social, and political standpoint, there is no sensible reason against a system of government for Negroes by Negroes.
Garvey decided that it's on his return from America to organize a political party, the People's Political Party, and its purpose would be to bring about the development of a country. For instance, among the things he had in mind was a university, which is a fact today, a polytechnic, which is not yet a fact. He had in mind that Montego Bay should become a city of corporate status. Port Antonio also, Montego Bay is today a city. But Port Antonio had not yet attained that status. He had in mind that there should be the workers, there should be a working day of 8 hours for the working man. Well, that came about eventually after he had passed on. We have today the labor unions. Garvey was foremost in promoting that too. There was a movement in connection all with the UNIA. Those things were part of the plans of what he was doing.
Garvey's followers had almost no chance of winning the local elections. Most of his followers did not have the right to vote. He was sent to jail again, accused of having insulted the judiciary. Garvey lost the election. Bitter and disappointed, he left for England, where he believed he would be closer to the real source of political power. Jamaica was still ruled by England at this time. In England, he published a newspaper, The Black Man, and from across the Atlantic, he tried to keep his American organization from crumbling. With a regular column in the UNIA's New York paper, The Negro World, he tried to hold the once powerful UNIA together. Without Garvey's charismatic presence, the infighting within the UNIA grew. While the Negro World saluted the nationalist movement led by Mahatma Gandhi in India, Garvey was bitter about the problems within his own ranks.
There is no doubt that the Negro is his own greatest enemy. He is jealous of himself, envious and covetous. is accounts for most of our failures in business and other things.
Another cartoon of the time showed the UNIA at the crossroads of its existence. Using a petition signed by thousands, the organization tried to persuade the U.S. government to permit Marcus Garvey to return to the United States. But the government remained firm in its refusal. One of Marcus Garvey's last sensational acts was his appearance at the League of Nations in Geneva. There he presented a petition demanding that the former German colonies in Africa be given to the black people of the United States and the Caribbean to settle and govern. No one took him seriously. Even Haile Selassie, the exiled Ethiopian emperor, refused to receive him. Garvey suffered a stroke in 1940 in London.
The thing that I remember most about him is his physical appearance. Broad, short, strong person, always dressed in a three-piece suit, and he always seemed to be in a three-piece suit, and giving us money for candy, that sort of thing. So it really was a child's memory of a father. And this was in England, where we lived. And I went back to Jamaica because I was sick. I had arthritis in my right leg. I was advised, my mother was advised, that we should go back to the warm climate. So we left in 1938. And that was the last I saw of him.
Marcus Garvey died on the 10th of June, 1940, in London. His last request was not to be buried in this strange land, but that his remains should be taken home to Jamaica.
There was a friend of mine and a member of the organization, Leslie Alexander, who expressed the desire that the body should be brought back to Jamaica. He went, he told me that he would be going and trying to get it. But when he went on the first mission, he was not successful. Well, making a long story short, I wrote a letter and gave him, and he went on a second mission to England. When the body was brought, there was a claim that it was not the body of Marcus Garvey. So I said, well, the casket will have to go so that the people who know Garvey can identify him. Well, so it happened.
It remained to the first government of Jamaica, after the island gained its independence in 1962, to declare Garvey a national hero and to bring his body home. During his lifetime, Marcus Garvey was viewed with suspicion by the American government and the European colonial powers. Still, his ideas are just as radical today as they were then. The non-white people of the world are slowly beginning to realize that their future lies in closer understanding and cooperation with one another. Neo-colonial dependency can only be overcome through self-reliance and faith in one's own strength. Marcus Garvey always stressed the point that no nation can be independent in a true sense unless it controls its own economy.
I took part in the funeral, naturally. One of the beer.
Any leadership that teaches you to depend upon another race is a leadership that will enslave you. Any leadership that teaches you to depend upon another race is a leadership that will enslave. They gave leadership to our foreparents and that leadership made them slaves. But we have decided to find a leadership of our own to make ourselves free men. Our great scholars have advanced through the colleges and universities have thrown away the blessed record. Babylon did it. Assyria did it. France under Napoleon did it. Germany under Prince von Bismarck did it. England under America under George Washington did it. Africa with 400 million black people can do it. If you cannot do it, if you are not prepared to do it, then you will die. You race of cowards, you race of imbeciles, you race of good for nothing. If you cannot do what other men have done, what other nations have done, what other races have done, then you have better die. Can we do it? Yes. We can do it. Yes. We shall do it. Yes. We pray to God for vision and for leadership. Yes. And He has given us a universal vision. A vision that will not limit our possibilities to America. A vision that will not limit our possibilities to the West Indies. But a vision that said it must be a free and redeemed African. Christ the crucified, Christ the despised. We appeal to you for help, for succor, for leadership. When you endeavor to carry your burden up the heights of Calvary, when white men scorn you, when white men scorn you, when white men spat upon you, when white men pierce your side out of which blood and water gushed forth, it was a black man in the name of Simon the Syrian who took your cross and bore it up the heights of Calvary. And now that we are bearing our burden that being so heavy, we just ask that you just help us all of that. Oh yes, the cause is grand, the cause is true. Surely we shall not turn back. Oh, sail on, sail on, sail on, oh mighty ship of state, sail on. Sail on until the flag of the red, the black and the green is pushed upon the hills of Africa. Because the time has come for the black man to forget his hero worship of other races and to create and emulate heroes of his own. We must canonize our own saints, create our own martyrs, and elevate the positions of fame and honor black men and women who have made a distinct contribution to our racial history.